First, I'd like to thank Professor Sang Il Eum for giving me this wonderful opportunity to speak at KAIST. It's always a great pleasure for me to speak at KAIST in front of many familiar and handsome faces. So, I will talk about two conjectures of Kenyon and Wilson on big tilings. So first, I will explain the motivation of big tilings, and then I will explain the two conjectures, and then I prove them. At least I will sketch the proof of two conjectures. Okay. Oh, by the way, I arrived from Minnesota here yesterday, so I was okay until 1 hour ago. Now I started to getting sleepy. So if I get asleep, please wake me up. Okay. So these are some basic definitions that will be used during the talk. So bracket n means the set of integers 1 through n. And matching on 2n integers is just matching. As you can see, you just, for each integer is matched to another integer like this. And then you can represent the matching using this diagram. Okay. And if you don't see any crossings like this, then if there are no crossings, then we call it a non-crossing partition, non-crossing matchings. Okay. And another object, important object, is dig path of length 2n. That is a lattice path consisting of up steps and down steps, so starting from the origin and 2n comma 0, such that it never goes below the x-axis. Okay. And if you look at the upper part, if you consider this imaginary n up steps and n down steps, then you can see the area between the imaginary path and this thick path, and you can see this diagram called the Ferris diagram. Then we can identify this with a partition. So we have four boxes, 2, 2, 1. So this is represents integer partition 4, 2, 2, 1. So we will identify this thick path and its corresponding integer partition. And it is well known that these three objects are all equinumerous, counted by the Catalan number, denoted by Cn. It's an easy exercise. Okay. And here's the motivation of dig tilings. So let's see, let's say G is a planar bipartite graph. And it will be drawn on a disk, and we will select some vertices on the boundary, meaning the circle. And D is a random dimer of perfect matching, and D prime is a random dimer of G minus the boundary vertices. And actually, if you look at this diagram, it should be clear. So we have a graph G, just ignore these blue edges. So then we have 6 by 6 vertices connected like this, like a grid. And the six vertices, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, are the boundary vertices. So D is the matching represented by these blue edges. And here, we will delete the boundary vertices, and we'll consider another random dimer, or random perfect matching here. And if you superimpose these two random dimers, then we get another diagram like this. And as you can see, each connected component is either a cycle or a path connecting one boundary vertex and another boundary vertex. So you can see one is connected to 6, 2 is connected to 3, 4, 5, etc. So if you have two random dimers, then, or we can say double dimer, if you have double dimer, then you can associate to it a matching. Actually, it's non-crossing matching because it's planar bipartite graph. So this diagram gives, this double dimer gives this non-crossing matching. So one can ask this question, what is the probability that a random dimer has this connected configuration? That's the question Kenyon and Wilson were interested in. And they, so this is, if you say this is pi, then p of pi is the probability that a random dimer has exactly this matching. Okay. So in order to compute this probability, they considered this matrix. So we have a thick path. We will consider an operation defined like this. So it's push-down operation. So we will take a matching pair of upstep and downstep. So this upstep, if you draw a horizontal line, then you will see the first downstep. So we say that it is a matching pair of upstep and downstep. And we will push down this step. Then we get this. So we, by push down, I mean just change this upstep to a downstep, change this downstep to an upstep. So we can kind of push down the upper part. This is a push-down operation. And we will we'll define a binary relation, lambda and mu, the thick path lambda and thick path mu. Okay. Let's just simply say that lambda is bigger than mu. If lambda can be obtained from mu by simultaneous push-down operation, that means you may select more than one matching pair. You may select three or four matching pair first, and then you do the push-down operation at the same time. So if you select these two matching pairs, and if you apply the push-down operation to both of them at the same time, then you get this path. Then we say that this lambda is bigger than mu. But actually, that's not a good way of saying bigger or smaller, because this is not a partial order. It's not transitive, because we have to do this simultaneously. If you ignore this simultaneous, then it's a partial order. But so if you do this simultaneously, then it's not a partial order. It's not transitive. But we can still consider this binary relation. All right. Then we have this matrix M indexed by thick path. Rows and columns are indexed by thick path of length 2n. So the size is actually cn by cn, the Catalan number. The entry is 1 if the row is bigger than the column, and 0 otherwise. Okay, so this is a 0-1 matrix. And what they showed is that one can compute this probability, the probability that I showed you in the previous slide, using the inverse matrix of this. Okay, so it's meaningful to consider the inverse matrix of this. Okay, so that's the motivation. And they also show that the inverse of this matrix has very nice combinatorial interpretation. So they show that the inverse matrix, the lambda mu entry is some sign times number of cover inclusive thick tilings of shape lambda mu. So I told you lambda is a thick path, but we can also identify this with a partition. So it's a partition, so another partition, so we can consider the skew shape, meaning the area between lambda and mu. And I will define these cover inclusive thick tilings in the next slide. So this is the motivation of thick tiling. Okay. Good. So what are thick tilings? So first consider thick tile. Thick tile is a tile that looks like a thick path. So if you connect the centers of the cells, then you get a thick path. So this is a thick tiling is a tiling consisting of thick tiles, of course. So this is lambda. This is mu. So lambda slash mu is the area between lambda and mu. We will fill this area with thick tiles. You can see every tile is a thick tile. And we need cover inclusive thick tilings. So what's the definition of cover inclusiveness? All right. So a cell A, we say that a cell A is covered by cell B if A is directly above B. Right? And cover inclusive detailing is a detailing with this property. If a tile A has a cell covered by at least one cell of B, another tile B, then A must be completely covered by B. So for instance, this is the same as this tiling. It's not a cover inclusive detailing. Because if you look at this red tile, blue tile, you can see at least one cell of A is covered by a cell of B, right? It's this one. This cell is covered by this, but the entire tile is not covered by this. So it's not a thick, it's not cover inclusive. Though, of course, you can find more illegal pairs. This, maybe this is easier. This, if you look at this tile and this one cell, then it doesn't cover this. On the other hand, if you look at this detailing, then it is cover inclusive. If you take any two pairs, they satisfy this condition. If one cell is covered by another, then the tile is completely covered. And from now on, I will always consider cover inclusive detailings, so I will simply just omit this phrase. So I will just say detailing instead of saying cover inclusive detailing. Any questions so far? Alright. So this is the definition. So the inverse matrix of the M matrix has meaning that the absolute value is the number of detailing like this, cover inclusive. Okay. So, and then I'm going to explain two interesting conjectures of Kenyon and Wilson on these detailings. So some notations. So D of lambda mu denotes the set of detailings of shape lambda mu. Okay? And I will use this asterisk mark that says we don't have any restriction here, so it can be any dictate. This means only the lower dig path is specified. Here, only the upper part, upper path is specified. And if you only have this number 2n, then that means all dig tilings of size 2n. Okay? So, the cardinality of this is equal to the row sum of the inverse matrix. Absolute value of the inverse matrix, meaning this is the matrix whose entry is the absolute value of the entries of M of B. So if you ignore the signs, then the cardinality of D of lambda slash star equals the rows, and of course this is the column sum. And this is sum of all entries. And there are two conjectures about these two numbers. And in fact, Q generalizations of these two numbers. It turns out that all of these three have nice formula. They're all factored very nicely. For instance, this is just 2n double factorial, meaning product of all odd integers less than 2n. And we will see this later. So they have very nice conjectures, formula. And in order to state the full generality of the conjecture, we need some more definitions. A chord of a dig path is a matching pair of up step and down step. We saw this earlier. So this is a chord, another chord. We have many chords here. And you will define two quantities assigned to a chord. The length, denoted by this absolute value of C, is the number of cells, horizontal cells that can be fit inside this chord. So we can put 1, 2, 3 cells horizontally here. So the length of this cell, this chord is 3. Okay? And the height are defined naturally the height of the lowest chord is 1, the one above it has height 2 and 3, 4, etc. So we have two statistics, okay, length and height. And I will define another statistic on assigned to dictyling. We say it is art statistic. Okay. We name this art not because we think this is beautiful. Actually, we think this is beautiful, but then we have better reason. Can you guess why? Okay. What does this mean? This is the number of cells between the lambda and mu. So this is basically the area of the region. What is this? Number of tiles. So this is area plus tiles. Evaluate art. So this is the idea of David Wilson, one of my co-author. And actually he suggested another alternative of this name. Write tiles first. T-A-R. Tar. So actually I have a paper with three co-authors, David Wilson being one of them, and so he suggested this statistic, and actually I voted for TAR, but that seems to be a bad choice, so we decided to stick to art. But anyway, this is a statistic art. And this is the usual Q integers, bracket N sub Q is defined to be 1 plus Q plus dot 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 Q to the N minus 1. And bracket n sub q factorial is product of integers, the usual q integers. So if q equals 1, this is just n, integer n, this is n factorial. So here comes the first conjecture of Kenyon and Wilson. They show that if you fix the lower path, then the generating function for the art statistic has this nice formula. N factorial, NQ factorial divided by the length of the Q of the chords, the product of all lengths of the Q. Okay? If you know some numeration of trees, then you will notice that this in fact has another meaning. In terms of trees, we will see this a little later. And the second conjecture is about the column sum. So if you fix the upper path, then the generating function for the number of tiles is equal to the nice product. Again, we product over all chord of mu, and we multiply the height of Q of the chord. Okay, and so it's a conjecture of them, and I proved them both. I proved both of them. Actually, these are some facts. So conjecture one, the first conjecture, has been proved by myself, but it was not by objective proof. And later on, myself, Massaros, and Panova, Wilson, we proved this bijectively. So first, I proved this non-bijective, actually inductive computation, and then later on we found a combinatorial proof. Conjecture 2, I found a bijective proof, and I found that later, that after exchanging some emails with Konvalinka, I knew that he had an independent proof of this, actually identical proof of mine. So these are the two conjectures that we will be interested in. Okay, so I will tell you how I proved the first conjecture. In fact, I will not going to explain the full detail of this proof. I will only give you a very brief sketch how I did this. In fact, I generalized this conjecture, the conjectural formula. In this conjecture, we have this dictyling. What is a dictyling? It's a tiling of the area between two dict paths. And the two dict paths start start at the same point and end at the same point. And we will generalize this, we will make this more flexible. So we still have two lattice path, now it's a lattice path. But the lower path is a Dieck path, the upper path is, can be any lattice path that's above this lambda. And it may start some vertically above, and it may end above the endpoint of lambda. Okay? So this notation L of lambda semicolon A comma B is a set of all lattice path starting from this point, which is A unit above, strictly above the origin, and ends B unit strictly above the endpoint of lambda. So if what happens if A equals B equals zero? Then that's just a normal Dieck path above lambda. So this is generalization. And you can still fill this region with some these zigzag things, attach it, but you can still fill the area between lambda and mu. Okay? And I prove this generalization. So the summation of this quantity, this arc generating function for all Dieck tilings is equal to this factor times this, where this capital delta of sub n is the highest path, meaning n steps, first n steps, and then first the last n down steps. Okay. Why is this a generalization of conjecture 1? If A equals B equals 0, this left-hand side becomes the left-hand side of conjecture, because I'm sorry, this is a typo, it's lambda slash star. So mu can be anything, and it starts at the same point, and at the same point is exactly the Dieck tiling. It's usual Dieck tiling. And what is this? Lambda equals, A equals B equals zero. So this is the lower path. And the upper path is above this. But this is the highest path. It starts at the same point and at the same point. So in this set, we have only one path, the same thing. And we don't have anything there. So the number of arc statistics is zero. So Q to the zero is one. So this reduces to the conjecture 1. Okay? And then I prove this generalization. This is a generalization, so in some sense it's easier than the proof, the original thing. Sometimes generalization is easier. Why is this easier? I'll just give you why this can be easier. Oh, yeah.
What was the definition of lambda?
Oh, this one?
Yes.
Yeah, the definition is over here. This is a generating function of the Dieck tilings, but lambda is Dieck path. Mu is a lattice path that starts A unit above the setting point of lambda. It ends at B unit above the ending point of lambda. Okay, so it's when A equals B equals zero, this is exactly the left-hand side of the original conjecture. So the generalization, and it is easier to prove because we can, here we have inductive recursive structure. If you have this Dieck path, there's a very natural way to decompose this Dieck path into several things. So to find the first point that hits the x-axis, then this, the first part is a Dieck path, and the second part is also a Dieck path. So you can decompose a Dieck path into two Dieck paths. If you have this Dieck path, then by the cover inclusiveness, we can cut this whole tiling into two parts. And if you just cut this at this vertical line, then the left part is a cover inclusive Dieck tiling of the smaller size. And the second part is also a cover inclusive thing. So we can, in fact, write this as a sum of smaller Dieck tiling. So we can somehow use recursive structure of this, so we can prove. But we need some computation. I'm not going to do that because we have a better proof, if you want, bijective proof. So, yep, this is a familiar thing, the right-hand side of conjecture 1, but this is different. P is an increasing planar tree. Okay, let me show you what that means. Okay, let me just draw you. All right, let's say it's just... So this is a plane tree. Plane tree is a tree that's drawn on the plane, and we care the order of the children. So this is the root. So this this point is different from this. Their order must be concerned. So if you flip this to children, then you get different trees. Okay, and we label this with integers 0, 1, dot, 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 n, so that if you travel from the root to a leaf, then you get increasing sequence. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So this is an increasing plane tree. Okay. And we can say the shape of this in terms of a big path. If you look at this, consider a worm traveling this tree, starting from this root, and it kind of walk the branches like this. Okay. And whenever you see, so this is an up step, and if it goes down, it's a down step. So first, it's an up step, down, down, up, 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 sorry, up, down, up, up, down, 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 and then up, down. So you can see the dig path. If you have a plane tree, then actually plane tree is in bijection with dig path. So if you consider the underlying plane tree, then you get a dig path, and we say that this is the shape of this plane tree. All right. Okay. And so we have this natural statistic, inversion statistics. That means the number of pairs. Inversion statistic is a pair ij such that I is smaller than j, I is bigger than j, but I appears earlier than j in this traveling. For instance, 4 appears earlier than 1, but 4 is bigger than 1, so this 4 comma 1 is an inversion. 4 comma 6 is not an inversion. What about 3 comma 1? Is there an inversion? Actually, that's not, because 1 appears earlier, so inversion is a pair that satisfies this condition. And the inversions, the generative function for the inversion statistics of all plane trees with fixed shape can be written as this nice formula, n factorial divided by the coordinate. This is exactly the right-hand side of conjecture 1. So this is proven by Buono and Wax, 1989. So because we know this theorem, if you can find a bijection between dig tilings and increasing planar trees with fixed shape, and of course we have to check the translation between this art statistic and inversion statistic. If they fit all nicely, then we can get the conjecture 1 bijectively. So this is how we proved it. So we prove that there is a bijection from dig tilings to increasing plane trees such that the lower path corresponds to the shape of the tree. And then the art statistic is translated into the inversion statistics. So the right-hand side, the generating function for dig tilings, art statistic equals this. This bijection shows us the left-hand side of conjecture equals this And because of this theorem, we get the right-hand side of the conjecture. So that's the proof. So if you know there's such a bijection, then we are done. And I mean,
so,
yep.
So the original proof for the 1989 theorem was bijective?
Yes. And the proof is not not that hard. Yep. Good question. If this is not a bijective proof, then our proof will not be a completely bijective proof. Yeah, this actually is a nice bijective, a simple and nice bijective proof of this. All right, so I will show you this bijection in the next slide. The bijection can be defined recursively. We will see that trees and dig tilings have the same recursive structure. So first, this is just so trivial, so you know, don't do anything. So what's the recursive structure of this increasing plane tree? At each stage, we can add the largest number as a leaf. So if you want a plane tree, increasing plane tree with one more integer, then you can just add 8 to any of these. You can add 8 over here or here, anyway. So, okay. So if you add 2 the left of 1, then we have, so here we have, if there are n integers, excluding this 0, then there are 2n plus 1 ways to insert the next integer. Now, let me give you the example. This is a, all right, let's say, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Let's say we want to add the next integer, 6. How many ways to insert 6? It can be inserted here or here because we consider the order. There are actually many ways. Are you guys all? So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. 5, 2 times 5. In general, if there are n integers, and if you add n plus 1, there are 2 n plus 1 ways to insert. And so we have 2 n plus 1 ways to insert. Let me show you. Let's just skip the first few steps because they are kind of obvious. All right. So now, we want to add 7. 7 will be added at top of 3. In 3, this in fact corresponds to this. Okay? So we have 2n plus 1 ways to insert a vertical line. We can add at this point or this, etc. So we have, if the length is 2n, there are 2n plus 1 vertical lines. So this is 1 to second position, so 1, 2. So we will add, we will expand this dig tiling at this vertical line. Okay? So we expand it, we will kind of cut this at this point, and then we will split this two parts, and then like this. And then for all up steps after this vertical vertical line, we add one cell. This is the step. Okay? So now, what is this? 8 is inserted between 4 and 5. Actually, that is this point. So this, we'll expand at this vertical line and expand and then add one cells to all up steps after this vertical line, but we don't have any, so we don't do anything. And 9 is added at this vertical line, so we add one vertex, one cell over here. And 10 is added at this vertical line, and then we add one cell to each up step after this vertical line, etc. So, and so on. And in this way, this is always cover inclusive dig tilings, because we expand, that preserves the cover inclusiveness. Okay, but it goes like this. Oops, yep. So, and finally, if you add 11 over here, then we expand at this vertical line, so we get. Okay, so at each step, a dig tile maybe stretches a little, or it stays as it is. So it's always cover inclusive. So this is a bijection, and we have to check that this inversion statistics corresponds to the number of tiles plus area divided by 2, but it's not difficult to check, so I'm not going to do that. So this is the bijective proof. Okay, so that's the proof of the first conjecture. Now we need to prove the second conjecture. And we have tell you two proofs again. First, inductive, and then bijective. But in fact, those two are pretty much the same. They'll be kind of identical. So, because if you know the first proof, this naturally leads to a bijective proof. Okay. All right. So I will induct on the number of cells below the mu. Okay, let me show you this. Okay, so this is mu. Oh, sorry. I think I can just start with this. This is mu. And we consider all dig tilings with this as an upper path. So we may have some dig tilings below this. And we will focus on one cell over here. And we have two choices, two cases. This cell itself is a dig tile or not. If this is a dig tile, then what? You add this dig tile, and then if you remove this dig tile, then the remaining tiling is still a cover inclusive dig tiling. So we have a smaller mu, meaning we have smaller cells below this new mu. So we can apply induction hypothesis to this dig tile, to this the upper dig path. Okay? But if you change this mu into this new dig path, then what happens to the height? We will lose this chord of height h, but we will gain a chord of height h minus 1. So if you consider this case, we will have h minus 1, or height of h minus 1, but we will lose height of chord of height h. So we have to multiply this. And this q is for the dig tile over here, because that will be added as a tile. And the other case is what? This cell is not itself by itself a dig tile. Then by cover inclusiveness, if you consider this area below this S, they must look exactly the same. Because you cannot have the single cell like this. That's not going to be a dig tiling. That means you can actually forget about the column between these two lines. And if you delete this line and attach the remaining two parts, then you get another dig tiling. And this is a dig tiling of a smaller size. You can also apply the induction hypothesis. And what happens to the height? We will lose one chord of height h, and the remaining do not change. So we only have this factor 1 over h. If you add these two together, then you get the desired formula. That's the inductive idea. Okay? And if you know this inductive structure, then actually you can construct this bijection, and maybe you like the second page better, because that's a little more fun. But of course we need some definition. So because I want to show you the bijective proof of this, I need a definition. Hermit history. This is a labeling of dig path. We will label down steps of dig tile. Okay, and this is Hermit history. And okay, let's forget about these statistics for the moment. So this is a dig path, and for each down step, we have a label, and the label is an integer, non-negative integer, at most the height minus 1. So this is height 3, so 4. So this, the label of this down step can be any of 0, 1, 2, 3. So I chose 2. The label of this can be 0, 1, 0, 1, 2. And we've chosen as 1, etc. So this is Hermit history. And there is a natural bijection between Hermit histories and matchings. Bijection goes in this way. So up step, if you have an up step, you start an arc. And if you see a down step, you finish an arc. But you connect this so that this corresponds to the number of crossings. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4 up steps. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4 edges. And then this step has label 2, so we will connect this to the second one so that we have 2 crossings. So this is the bijection. So the sum corresponds to the number of crossings. So we have 2, 0, 0, 1, 1. We have the sum is 4. We have 1, 2, 3, 4 crossings. Okay. So actually, so the sum of the labels corresponds to the crossings, and the maximum number minus h corresponds to the nesting, but let's forget about this. And then now I can explain the dig tiling bijection between dig tilings and Hermit histories. And this is a dig tile, and we define an entry and an exit in this way. So the last cell has the entry, and the first cell, the leftmost cell, has the exit. The rightmost cell has the entry. Okay. And here is the bijection. This is actually very easy to describe. So we have a dig tiling. We want to associate to it a Hermit history. So we already have this dig path. We only need to label the down steps. So for each down step, we will travel this tiling using these entries and exit. Whenever you see an entry, you travel this dig tile. And then if you reach the exit, and see if you can see if this corresponds to an entry of another tile. Then if it is an entry, then you keep traveling. Otherwise, you stop. So here we travel, and this is the exit, is another entry. So we keep traveling, and then we finish here. So we have, when the label is the number of tiles that you travel. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4 tiles. So we label this down step with 4. And this is this. We have one tile. And then we stop here because this is not an entry. Okay? So we have 1, 2, 3 tiles, so we label this with 3. This is in fact a bijection. Actually, the labeling is the easy part, but if you know only the labelings, you have to construct these thick tilings, but that's not as obvious as this bijection. But if you know the inductive structure that I showed in the previous slide, then you can actually construct this thick tiling. So this is a bijection. Okay. So this is the bijective proof of the second conjecture. All right. Yeah. And we can kind of keep track of the statistics, crossings, and nestings. But because we don't have enough time, I will not talk about this. Wait. But so this is the generating function for the tilings, but this corresponds to the labels. Number of tiles is exactly the labels. So if you add these numbers, then you get tilings, the number of tiles. But because this is Hermit history, this number can be anything between 0 to the height minus 1. So actually here you may have 0, 1, 2, 3, dot, 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 and minus 1. And if you consider the number of tilings, then that can be 0. That this gives you the factor 1 plus q plus dot, 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 q to the n minus 1. That is n bracket q, q integer. So for each down step, you have a factor, this. That gives you this, the proof of this. This is the proof, bijective proof of second. Alright, so now this is some corollaries, because we know that, okay, another corollary is this. What is the number of all Dick tilings? That's the number of all Hermit histories. But we know that the number of Hermit histories are in bijection with matchings. What's the number of matchings? There are 2n integers. The number of matchings is 2n double factorial. Because if you have 2n integers, first you need to connect 1 with any of the remaining 2n minus 1 integers. So for 1, you have 2n minus 1 choices. And if you add connect this with something, then you now have 2n minus 2 integers. So you have 2n minus 3 choices for the next edge, and then etc. So that gives you 2n double factorial. So so this also gives us that Dick tilings are in bijection with matchings. Okay. But if you specify this upper path, then you get this Hermit histories with the same underlying Dick path. Okay. I don't think I have enough time to explain these statistics, but because this corresponds to the number of crossings and nestings of matchings, and there is a nice way to relate this to nth moment of orthogonal polynomials of, but obviously I don't have enough time, sorry about that. So we can have something like this, but I will skip to the last slide. Okay. So the conclusions, 2 conjectures are true. We prove them. So they have nice factorization formula. So these 2 statistics, art and tiles, are nice. So another conclusion. And you may ask this question, the next thing, if you have a Dick tilings or something like this, you can always consider symmetric things. What happens if you only consider symmetric Dick tilings? So by symmetric, I mean you can draw the central line, and the tiling, the entire thing, is symmetric about this line. So you can see, if you flip this part, you get exactly the right part. So that's usually called a type B analog symmetric part, but symmetric Dick tilings. And are there nice type B analogs of these 2 theorems? And the answer is yes. And this is a work in progress. And if lambda is symmetric Dick path, and if you consider symmetric Dick tilings of this fixed lower path, and we have to define this art statistic for type B version, and we have this nice vectorization. And then for the second conjecture, if you again consider symmetric Dick tilings with upper fixed Dick path, and if you define these tilings type B version, then we also have this nice factorization. But we have another factor that's defined by this. This is in fact, if Q equals 1, this is the number of involutions of N. Okay, so we have a nice type B generalization. I prove this using the bijective proof, but because the bijective proofs have nice structure that can be used to study symmetric Dick tilings, so we can have this theorem. So sometimes bijective proof, and in many cases in combinatorics, bijective proof are better, because if you know this bijective proof, you can understand this object better, and you can apply to many interesting things like symmetric part or things like that. All right, that's all. Thank you.
Any questions?